Great, everyone. Well, I suppose we'll start to kick off. I'm Rebecca Keating, a barrister at Four Pump Court.
And I am Katie Simmonds, Managing Associate at Womble von Dickinson.
Thanks all for joining us today, an event to mark and celebrate Business Women's Day.
So today we are joined by triple Olympian swimmer Fran Halsall. So it is easy to see how you can draw parallels between Fran's challenges as a successful athlete and the influence of swim technology on her career with a career in law and technology. We are really excited to hear from Fran, who will be talking about big goal setting, ambition and overcoming challenges.
And then later in the event, we'll be holding a panel discussion where we'll be speaking with women across the law and tech world who have carved out their careers. But first, Fran, over to you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Katie, and thank you, Rebecca, for introducing me. But I'm Fran. I'm a three-time Olympian. I competed at Beijing 2008, London 2012, and the Rio 2016 Olympic Games. I'm a world champion, Commonwealth champion, and European champion swimmer across butterfly, backstroke, and freestyle. So a bit of a jack of all trades, to say the least. And still to this day, since retiring, I can count myself as one of the fastest women to ever swim a length of the swimming pool, which now looking back, I do quite enjoy being able to say that. I'm really looking forward to sharing some insights with you guys today from my career and just a few things that I've learned along the way at the elite end of sport. But just to give you a bit more about me, I'm just going to show a quick video of just some of my racing, really.
Two this year. She's the only swimmer sub 24.
England, Francesca Halsall.
Can't believe she's going to do it though, because here Fran Halsall, well, unless something really horrible happens, Fran swam an utterly wonderful new Commonwealth Games record.
Halsall though, I'm sure she wants to defend her European Championship title that she won 2 years ago, but Nielsen is really on top form.
She loves the crowd. I think she can do it.
There's Halsall, a dark freestyle in length three. There is Fran Halsall, coached by James Gibson. Well, she's pretty late to the rest of the year, so and at the moment she's going well, coming back there is Tumble Yo-Yo, it looks like maybe it'll be Fran. Fran takes the first, this second semi-final relay, and she's going very well at the moment, Fran Halsall. She's just going to hold the script, she's charging back as Nielsen in four. Charging back is, and Fran Halsall very close, so just one 1/100 of a second outside, but it's a new championship record. But it's gold to Fran Halsall of Great Britain.
And a new English record for Fran. She loves that.
Like a little kid in a sweet shop. She loves this.
Wow. Fran Halsall is on fire tonight. 24.21. British record low.
Back here, broke that world record on the 4x100 free, but who is the fastest qualifier? Fran. Women's 50 metres freestyle, Fran Halsall of England in there in the centre, but some very big Aussies all around her, and the black hat's right in the centre. She's had a good start, Fran Halsall, a very fast turnover but powerful as well, starting to come back closer to us in the Australian hats, the yellow hats of Kate Campbell, but it looks like it's Fran Halsall at the moment. Halsall going well. If Halsall could get to the touch, it's going to be tight. Oh my goodness me, I think she may have it. Yes, she does. 23.96. Fran Halsall from England is the Commonwealth champion on the 50 metres freestyle, and I've got to say, a massive shock. Oh my goodness, that is absolutely brilliant.
Well, fantastic. 4/100 of a second ahead of Kate Campbell. A match to stroke for stroke, and that will not have been accepted or expected by the Campbells. Well, in an interview before this meet, I think it was Bronte Campbell called Fran Halsall a pocket rocket and a smiling assassin sprint program in Loughborough. What a fantastic job you've been doing there. Look here. Really holding that head down and getting a nice glide for. I mean, she really stretched forward, leant over to the right, just as you get a full stretch, you know, really extend the arm, punching the air. The most excited of the whole field, apart from Andy James in the commentary box, I have to say.
That is brilliant. That is the fastest time in the world this year, and that is utterly stunning. And what did she do? She concentrated on her own race all the way through to the finish. 4/100 since the margin of victory. On the process, she would have
got that, and the breathing was perfect. As you mentioned before, Andy, that's 15 metres, head down, didn't take a breath. Kept the stroke low onto the surface of the water. Played perfectly. Not giving. One arm pull, one arm stroke. Woman in the water at these Commonwealth Games. Freestyle fly, a brilliant double.
So talking about tech, I can only apologise if a minute into that you thought, yeah, Fran, we get it, we know what you do, but the BBC love a bloody Moncharge and they put that together for me. So to get there, how did I get to do all that? The races are so close, it's an intense atmosphere being an elite swimmer, but I should probably start at the very beginning. I set the goal of becoming, I wanted to be an Olympic champion. I set that when I was 13 years old, which is nuts. Like, what 13-year-old who's just starting out at high school decides they want to be an Olympic gold medalist? It's an audacious goal, to say the least. And at the time when I was wanting to do this, there hadn't been a female swimming Olympic champion for 30 years previous to when I was born. So I had no role models to look up to in that sense. I lived in a tiny village called Banks, which is on the outskirts of Southport. And don't worry if nobody's ever heard of it, because you shouldn't have. And I had to travel over an hour to get to training every single day. And not only that, when I got to training, the pool is 33 and a third yards long. So I couldn't even train the distances to actually compete at the Olympics, never mind actually getting there in one piece. And also, I'm 5'7", and it was a 6-foot girls world, the world that I competed in. You had to be big, you had to be strong. So it was an audacious goal that I'd set myself. Slightly nuts and slightly crazy, but I was all in for it. It lit up every single part of me. It gave me butterflies thinking about it. It made me feel a little bit sick. It made me really nervous, but excited in every single bit of my being when I envisaged achieving this goal. But I actually fell 6/100ths of a second short of achieving that goal. 6/100ths of a second. It's a blink of an eye. I've tried to stop the stopwatch on my phone at 0.06 and it's nigh on impossible. Can't do it quick enough. They were the margins between me succeeding at this ridiculous goal and failing at it. But do I count it as a failure? Probably not, because I don't think if I hadn't set that goal to that standard that inspired me in all those ways, I wouldn't be able to sit here today and say, I've been the fastest woman in the world. I've won world championship gold medals. I wouldn't be able to say all that if I hadn't set that goal. And what I believe that goal did for me, gave me direction, gave me purpose. It gave me clarity over my focus for all my days. That is what setting a ridiculous sounding goal does. It gives you clarity. It gives you purpose and focus. And it helps keep you motivated, right? Motivation is key, really. But everybody believes that elite athletes were motivated every single moment of every single day. But I can tell you right now, that is not bloody true at all. There's days even the best athletes in the world think, what the hell am I doing here? You've been to 10 swimming sessions that week. You've done 5 weight sessions, 2 Pilates. You've had British Swimming on the phone giving you grief about not doing enough meters. The last thing you want to do on a Saturday morning at 5 o'clock when it's pitch black, is be going to the pool. It's not where you want to be. You want to be either walking home from a night out with all your friends, or you want to be in bed asleep. You do not want to be diving into that freezing cold swimming pool. So why do you do it? Why did I decide to make the effort to get into the pool? It's all about that it's a choice. I never saw going to training like as a choice. It was what I did. That was my daily disciplines. I knew that I needed to do what it took every single day. So I had to let go of the fact that I wasn't motivated. And once I understood that that was okay, and I could still do my job to a great level and to the best of my ability without having that extra bit of motivation, It helped me get through what needed to be done. And so it's great when you are motivated. That's the icing on the cake. But nobody can be motivated every day. Everybody looks at what I do and think, oh, it was really cool, really sexy, really glamorous. Probably the same as being a lawyer, really. Everyone thinks that what you do is always great. It's always interesting doing stuff. But there's days where it's just doing what you need to get done. And that's what the best people in my line of work definitely understood. They understood that you just have to commit to doing your daily disciplines every single day, because consistency is key. And not everybody's consistent in what they do. People think that it's the cherries, the icing on the cake that make the difference, but it's not. It's the consistency when you're not motivated to do your job and get it done that makes the difference. And I'll move on to pressure, because pressure is probably similar in both, in all our lines of work. It's quite high pressure environments. Swimming was definitely at the elite end, high pressure environment, which on days I didn't deal with very well. I hold my hands up and didn't deal with it well. The London Olympic Games was the perfect example of that for me. I remember before London, I was on billboards, had great sponsors, I was ranked to get a medal. And I had all this pressure on me. It was like a pressure cooker of Fran should win a medal. So it's the word should really like resided over me. I got anxious, I got nervous. The point where I was making myself sick with the thought of this pressure of the London Olympic Games. And not only that, it's on one day. I had one day that was defined from the outset that I knew I had to perform. I had to swim the best 24 seconds of my life one day. That's it. There wasn't another day I could do it on. There wasn't another opportunity. It's always one day. That's the same year in, year out for swimming. All my funding for the next year is based on that one day as well. So any meet per year, one day defines whether I'll get paid the next year, basically. So if you don't perform on that one day, you're not paying your mortgage, you're not fueling your car, you're not getting fed. So it's quite a high pressure environment. And London, I did not handle it well, because I was thinking, I should win a medal here. I've got to do this. I've got to win a medal. So I added to the cauldron of intensity with it all. But it didn't work. And that was the worst mentality to be in. So I had to figure out how I changed my mentality from thinking I should do this, I've got to win. I changed it to a more optimistic approach. I told myself that, Fran, you just need to do your best. Everything's about doing your best every day. And you can't do any more than that. Why tell yourself that you should be winning this medal? You can't control that, Fran. What you can control is doing your best and executing what you're doing on that day to the best of your ability. And you got to enjoy it. It was a privilege to do what I did. I had to see this environment as a privilege to be there, to experience, to embrace. So instead of it being, it has to be perfect at all times, I've just got to do my best. And that change in mentality changed the like balance when it came to pressure for me. The pressure's always going to be there. I've still got to perform, because if I want to get paid next year, I've got to perform. But that never came into my mindset. I wasn't even thinking about that at a competition. All I was thinking about is I'm here to do my best, to enjoy the atmosphere, and I'm actually really bloody lucky to be here. And that really, really changed my mentality. And from then on, I started performing way better in those big events from that. But still, at big events, things can go wrong, right? And I've had, unfortunately or fortunately, quite a lot of things that have gone wrong for me in my swimming career. But everyone's had experienced things over the last 18 months, especially, where you think, where the hell has that come from? How's that happened? I'm gonna have to change this, gonna have to change that. Everybody has had to be resilient in some way over the last 18 months. And athletes are always given this badge of resilience, which is great, but also means that you've had a lot of times where things have, like, shit has hit the fan, haven't you? So don't know whether you want it. You prefer it to go more smooth sailing than that, but that's not the case. And for me, I've had things happen like I've had a swimming suit that's taken 45 minutes to get on when we had this era of real big tech investment in swimming. It took 45 minutes to get my racing suit on. I was about to walk up for my swim in a world championship final. The suit just burst open. I don't know whether I'd like a little bit heavier than usual or it was a bit hot, but the suit burst, not even ripped at the seams, fully burst down the middle. And I was like, I've got to go and race, but also I'm stood here pretty much nude on poolside. So there's two things I had to deal with at once in that situation. And other things like I had to fell over running and had to have ankle surgery. You just don't expect things like that to happen. Got sick at a meet. But all these things led to me understanding what I needed to do in those moments that are going to make the difference from being stuck in that moment and actually moving on and delivering what needs to be done. And this all kind of accumulated for me at the Rio 2016 Olympic Games. So going into Rio, I was feeling really good about my training. I'd had the perfect training block. So I knew I had a great opportunity. It was going to be great fun. I just had to execute my swims to the best of my ability there. So I turned up in Rio. I swam my heat of my 50 meters freestyle, qualified for the semi-final. Fantastic. And on those days, as a swimmer, you have your heats and semi-finals, the finals of the next day, and you have your timeline to within minutes. So I'll know I'll get out the pool at this point from my race. I'll go back to the athlete's village. I'll have some food. I'll have a nap. I'll have some more food. I'll get my bag together. I'll know exactly what time my race is that evening, and it'll all stem back from that. So I'm walking down to the bus center. They've got a massive kind of bus depot at the Olympics with all different like places. There's one for the judo, one for the taekwondo, one for the athletics. So they've got all these different like bus stops. So I'm getting on the bus to the swimming pool, and I'm with some of my other teammates, and there's a couple of girls also on there that are racing in the same event as me that night. So we kind of give each other a nod, a knowing nod, like, yeah, I'm going to beat you later. We all get on the bus, we're on the way to the pool. And I'd prepped for the fact that Rio traffic's pretty hairy at times, so it could take us a while to get there. So gave myself bags of time, reading my book, trying to take my mind off anything that's going to happen, trying to stay in neutral for as long as possible before I have to get in race mode. So I'm staying in neutral, reading my book. I'm getting a few more pages along than usual in this book. And I'm thinking, oh, it's taken a while, this is. But I was like, I've prepped for this. I know that it's going to take a while. I've got bags of time. Get a bit further through my book. I hear an Australian swim coach get up and like speak to the driver. And he asks the driver, how long till we get to the swimming pool? And the driver's English is a bit sketchy. And he goes, no swimming pool. So at this point, the bus erupts into chaos. Literally, it's just carnage. The Australian coach is screaming at the driver, who doesn't understand him because he's Portuguese. There's people laughing because they're not swimming, so it's an adventure that we're on. The two girls that I'm swimming with start to like totally lose their composure. And it turns out we're going to the athletics stadium, not the swimming pool. The bus had taken us to completely the wrong destination, which, when it's one of the most important days of your life, you don't need that, right? So I'm on this bus and I give myself a minute to go, for God's sake, Fran, you're going to miss your race. This is crap. It could only happen to you. But as soon as I'd said that to myself, I had to let it go. I knew I can't even think about that now. So what can I do? The only thing I could think about in that moment is, what can I do now? So when the shit hits the fan, it doesn't matter what's happening. It's what you can control from there that makes all the difference to how you're going to perform at the end and how quickly you're going to be able to get yourself back on track. So what can I do? I rang my coach, rang James. He's at the swimming pool already. He thinks I'm taking the mick, ringing him and telling him I'm going to miss my race. So when I finally got through to him that, yes, I am not going to be there in time, he said, leave it with me. You're not missing this race. So I've done what I can do then. I've not yet missed the race. So I have to stay in this neutral mode of not thinking I've missed my race until I actually have. The girls on the bus, one's crying, one's having an argument with a coach. Like, everybody's like having, the rest of the people having a party because they're seeing the sights of Rio. So it was still absolutely carnage. I get a phone call back from my coach. He says, we've sorted it. It's like, what do you mean you've sorted it? They'd managed to switch the whole schedule for that final session of that Olympic program so that we could make it to swim, which is totally unheard of. Like, American telly pay an absolute fortune for those rights, and they switched it for us three European girls that are stuck on this bus. So I got to the pool, and as I said, we've got to a T exactly everything that I do in that day. And I've got no time to do the rest of my preparation. I'm not going to be able to have the warm-up I'm used to having, see my physio, speak to my coach. I literally have to get to the pool, put my racing suit on, and dive in against the 15 other fastest women in the world to compete for your dream of competing in an Olympic final. So then all I could think about was, I know what my processes are. I had to rely on the fact that I've done this before and I can do it again. And I know that my body is physically ready to do this. I couldn't think about the fact that I hadn't had the preparation I wanted that day or what had happened beforehand. I had to just focus on what I could control in that moment. And in that moment, I could control how I executed my race plan to the best of my ability. And that is all I thought about. And I qualified, I won my semi-final. I qualified for the final of the Olympic Games. The other two girls that were going absolutely nuts on the bus, neither of them qualified. They didn't give themselves then the opportunity to compete in the final. So the ability to respond quickly in a logical way of what you're going to be able to do next in situations that arise, no matter what they are, is so important to be able to perform well. And literally, that was the turning point where I realized that you've got to be able to control your controllables and just focus on that. So set big, massive, whopping goals that scare you shitless, because you'll end up somewhere great if you do that. Motivation comes and goes, that's fine. Concentrate on consistency with what you know shows results day in, day out. And control your controllables, that's all you can do. Make sure you're focusing when things are going wrong or something hits you out of nowhere that you didn't expect. What can I do from this moment? It doesn't matter what's happened before. Thank you.
Thank you, Fran. What an inspiration. Really overwhelmed. That was amazing. That shift in mentality from should to doing your best and focusing on the controllables is just such a great takeaway. So continuing that theme, no pressure to the panellists after that. Fran will now be joined by our inspirational panellists. So you will remember our panellists from our bite-sized video series, which we have been releasing in the lead up to today's event. These videos feature in-house counsel, members of the judiciary, and women specialising in the implementation of technology.
Great. So during today's panel discussion, we'll be kind of hopping on a few of the themes that Fran has set up and chatted about really well. So we'll be discussing themes like imposter syndrome, finding a mentor, and how to know when it's time for a big move or a change in your career. And our wonderful panel today is made up of some really great and inspiring women. We've got Sue McLean, who's a partner at Baker McKenzie in the IP Data and Technology Group. Got Caroline Churchill, who's a partner at Womble, Bond, Dickinson at their digital group. Sarah Green, Law Commissioner for Commercial and Common Law. And also Emma Wright, who's a partner in Deloitte's commercial and technology team. We've also got a load of wonderful attendees who are on mute and not visible, but we would love to hear from you too. And there's going to be time for questions at the end. So please do feel free to pop anything in the Q&A box as we go along, either for Fran or any of the panelists, or just a thought or comment that you'd like to share with the group, that would be great. And you can also elect to pose your question anonymously if you prefer to do that as well.
Great, so my first question is for Caroline. So Caroline, being a mentor or mentee can be a really rewarding and beneficial experience. So firstly, do you think being a mentee is something you only need at the start of your career, or is something that you can benefit from throughout your whole career? And secondly, what would be your top tips for those looking to find a mentor? And also, what advice would you give on becoming a good mentor?
Thanks, Katie. And thanks, everybody, for having me here today. I just want to say to Fran that climbing into a cold swimming pool at 5 a.m. in the morning on a bursting swimsuit fills me with dread. But hats off to you. I think you're amazing. And that was a really inspirational talk. And your discipline and drive is phenomenal. So when I think about do I need a mentee throughout my career, it's something that I have actually used a lot over the years, because I think it's something that helps you channel your purpose and your focus and does help you to deal with pressure. I mean, Fran talked about the pressures that she experienced in her field, and as lawyers, it's a fairly demanding environment. So it's good to be able to have that sounding board. And I have found that a very rewarding experience. I've had lots of different mentors over the years, usually people in the law firms that I worked in, somebody in a senior role that could help me formulate my career and discuss questions with and help me to progress. But as I've sort of moved through the ranks and as I've got older as well, my challenges and my outlook on life have changed. And so for the first time, I've actually gone for a mentor who's outside of law. And he's somebody that works in business, and he's an extremely successful businessman. And he challenges me and makes me look at things in different ways and makes me share difficult experiences to learn from those and to try and get the best from myself and to get the best just from also from personal development as well as within my career. And it's something that I like to do and sort of pass that on, use it for myself, but also for those that I mentor in my line of work. And somebody once told me that being a mentor, when you're a mentor, it's a bit, you should be the passenger in the car. You should give directions and the encouragement, and it's for the mentee being the driver. It's for the mentee as a driver to find their way there. And I always used to think, crikey, I do hope I don't break down. I'm not the best driver in the world, but the guidance that I've had over the years has certainly helped me and help my career development, and I think my personal development as well. So I think, Katie, you asked me about tips on looking to find a mentor. So the type of things that I look at when I run through that in my head, I have the are they, do they, can they. So by this I mean, are they a good listener, do they have empathy, and can they encourage, can they bring out the best in me. So those are the types of things that I look for. And I'll often, if I think of somebody might be a good mentor for me, I will approach them with a problem and discuss it with them. Use them as a bit of a sounding board to see if there's that connection there and see if they can help me work through things. And another key thing is making sure you structure the sessions. People are busy. Mentors are usually pretty busy people. So it's using timing to make sure you get the most out of those sessions and what you want to achieve. And what advice would I give? I think you asked on being a good mentor. Get to know your mentee. Spend time with them. Get to know them. What are their challenges? Where are they at in their life? Where do they want to go? Set expectations around what they expect from you and what you can give them. And don't forget, I think it's not just about career development. Personal development is really key as well. One of the things that I worked on was confidence. And the people that were my mentors over the years have really helped me with that, enabling me to speak at events such as this. Other things that I think important as well is to introduce new ways of thinking, getting people to challenge how they look at life. It's easy to do that when you're on the outside looking in because you're not emotionally involved with it. And you can help people to challenge their limiting assumptions. And I think my concluding remark on it is share your life experiences. We've all been through different, parts of our lives, different things happen to us. And we've all had some challenges, not least over the last year or so. And life can be really, really hard. And if you share those life challenges, you can really help others. And that's the bit I find rewarding from being a mentor. So I hope that answers your questions.
That was great, Caroline. Thanks. And I think what's really great about that is so many kind of practical ways of approaching it as well, because sometimes a mentor-mentee relationship can become a bit of a beast of its own and hard to know what to do with it. So that's really helpful. Sue, we really liked the part of your interview where you talked about Facebook's motto, what would you do if you weren't afraid? And a lot of people can sometimes or even often suffer from imposter syndrome. We've probably got a few sitting on the webinar right now who maybe don't feel like that at this moment, but have experienced that as well. Do you have any advice on how to overcome that or deal with it?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, for me, I'm not sure you ever overcome it. It's just something you live with. I mean, I have to say, when I was a child, I wasn't like Fran saying, I want to be an Olympian. I was wanting to be a lawyer. So actually, I didn't have imposter syndrome when I was nine playing with my Barbies, but it certainly came to me over the years in my career. And I know that a lot of colleagues, male and female, you know, have those pangs of insecurity from time to time. I'm sure Olympians do. I'm sure, you know, politicians, however successful you are, the sort of voice in your head can sometimes be unhelpful. I mean, I think sometimes having imposter syndrome is not necessarily a bad thing. You know, it drives you. It makes you want to achieve. It means, you know, you're careful. But it's when it's debilitating, I think, or where it stops you achieving your potential, that it's a struggle. And I certainly have had times in my life, you know, and it happens, you know, every week. You know, I might have a moment where I just think, oh, I'm just not sure I'm up for this, or I'm not sure I'm capable, or how did I get here? Why is someone trusting me with this? But I think the important thing is to recognize it is just a voice in your head, and you can choose to ignore it or go with it. And what I loved about the Facebook mantra was it's a very practical question. You know, what would you do if you weren't afraid? If you weren't afraid of public speaking, you'd, you know, attend an event, you'd speak in a seminar. If you weren't afraid of something going wrong, you might just push yourself a bit more for that new job or that new role or that new assignment. And so I found it a very liberating kind of principle that really, if I'm a bit scared about something, that doesn't mean I shouldn't do it. I should just say yes and worry about it later, because later the voice in my head might go away and I'll do well and it will be fine. So to me, it can be a sort of positive thing, but I think it's really important. It's really important, as Fran and everyone has said, it's just, you know, to know what you want to achieve and don't let yourself get in your own way. You know, think of you, I think practically sometimes it's, for me, it's thinking about myself as if I'm a, you know, one of my mentees or someone I think's amazing. You know, I wouldn't have these questions about them. I would be truly supportive of them. So why am I not, you know, giving myself the same luxury and pointing, you know, reminding myself of my achievements or reminding myself of some, you know, job I did well or some positive feedback. I think all of those things are helpful and reassuring to try and just ignore that imposter when they pop up at unhelpful times. And I think the other thing I would say is that I think in certain lines of work or certain roles, that it comes to women or it comes to certain types of people, because actually you look around and you think, I am quite unique in this environment. So, you know, it may feel a bit legitimate to be an imposter, like, why am I involved in this? Why am I in the room? But we all know, you know, and certainly at SEL, you know, inclusion and diversity means that we want lots of different types of people in the room. And you can be the most junior person in the room with a lot to give, a lot of new ideas, a lot of, you know, perspectives that other people wouldn't have. So you must never think that, you know, I'm not sure I really deserve to be here, you know, because we want a sort of multitude of personalities and contributions and everything like that. So, yeah, to me, it's, you know, a few mantras are in my head. That one, another friend of mine said, you know, proceed until apprehended. They're all kind of the same message, which is, you know, be confident in yourself, but don't get too stressed out when you don't feel productive or you don't feel confident. Those concerns are completely natural. And the final point I was just going to say is that it really helped me as part of this kind of journey that I went on in my career, when somebody said to me once, you know, Sue, you are comparing your inside to everybody else's outside. And what you don't know is what's happening in their head. You know, when you line up, whether it's at the 100 meter, you know, at the Olympics or for a job interview or whatever, you're looking down the line and thinking they look so assured, they look so confident, they don't have these concerns. Well, probably, you know, 7 out of 10, if not all of them do. They're just quite good at hiding it. And you're probably quite good at hiding it as well. So yeah, that's my main message, is kind of just don't let yourself get in your own way and really shoot for the stars, as Fran did, because you know what, you might not win an Olympic medal, you might not get the top job, but you'll never know unless you try.
Love that. So we have lots of questions in. A question for Emma. One bit of advice that came up a lot in the videos was naturally to take opportunities and to say yes more often, even if you're afraid of taking the leap. So flipping that, do you think that sometimes it is right to say no to an opportunity? And if so, how do you know when your time and efforts would be better served by saying no and conserving your effort for something else?
Sure. Lovely to speak to everyone. Can I just say, I've got serious imposter syndrome having watched Fran's video. I thought it was excellent as well. So we all sit here with it. As far as saying no goes, so I'm very much come from a mindset that I like change, which has meant I tend to say yes to things that are interesting, probably a bit too often, particularly when I was younger. But I think it's really important for you to recognise when either that change doesn't suit you or actually something won't work for you. And how I've got my kind of put a structure around it as I've developed is, yes, have your big goals of what you would, you know, you want to achieve. We're slightly different in our career in that it's far longer, it spans many, many years. So set your big goals. And then what I've done is ended up coming up with really a 2 to 3 year plan where I scaffold how I achieve those goals. Now, why 2 to 3 years? Honestly, because I worked out that, because I've got an 11 and a 13 year old, 2 to 3 years, my kids probably have a changing need or environment. You know, recognize that actually, yes, we have a career. That's one aspect of who we are, actually. There are other roles that I have in my life that are equally important. And so what are the kind of the quick things that I think about? So one is, am I saying no because that's coming from a place of fear or strength? Am I saying no because I'm scared, I don't think I'm capable of it? Or am I saying no because I don't want to do it? It doesn't work for me. Am I interested in it? Kind of, am I interested in what someone's asked me to do? Do I have the time? And then will it help me achieve my wider, achieve my 2 to 3 year plan or whatever plan you've got going? If I'm saying I'm not interested in it and I don't have the time, that they're the flags. Say, you know, you can say no from a position of strength. If I'm saying I'm not interested in it, but I think it will help me achieve where I want to be in 2 to 3 years time, why am I saying that? Why am I not interested in it? Is it because it's the wrong opportunity for me? Is it that actually I think that something else will be coming along that will be better suited for me? And then actually, when I was talking about it with my team, because I work with a lot of amazing female tech lawyers, one of them said, well, it's channeling Michaela Cole, isn't it? What she said, it's about not being afraid to have the silence and to see what comes from the silence. I mean, I paraphrased it, it was amazing, but it's that. And that's how they're the basic rules of how I guide whether I say yes or no to most things that come up.
That's great, Emma, thanks. And I love the, I suppose, the soundbite of, is it coming or motivated from fear or strength, which I think is just such a good way of summing up thinking about how you feel about a decision like that. Sarah, in your video, you described your career as a series of happy accidents, which I thought was such a lovely way of describing such a successful career in such a humble way, but also really interesting as well. How do you know, one, that it's time for a change? And two, do you have any advice for those who are thinking about whether they should make a big move or shift in their career?
Thanks very much, Rebecca. And I'd like to say as well, thank you for inviting me to join this panel. Everybody's incredibly impressive, and it's lovely to hear from you all. And Fran, I had a particular stab of empathy when you were talking about the bus situation, because I am renowned for getting lost and not getting to places, although it's always my fault. I mean, in your case, you didn't do anything wrong, but usually it'd be me getting on the wrong bus. So yeah, I really felt for you in that one. And I'm going to, next time it happens, I'm going to practice what you set out there about controllables. So yeah, moving on from one job and sometimes career to the next.
When do you know? Well, in my case, I've identified with what a couple of other people have already said, particularly Emma, who's just said that she likes change. I'm somebody who likes change. For me, it's when, for want of a better way of putting it, when my job stops terrifying me, really. I mean, I quite like the idea of getting up in the morning and having and not knowing whether I can actually deal with everything that I have facing me that day and not knowing the answers. I quite like that. Once those butterflies in my stomach go away and I think that I can just deal with everything quite easily, that's when I feel like I need something else to go to. But what I would say, from my experience with colleagues and with friends, is of course everybody has to know their own pull and push points, really. And I think it's very important, even given everything I've just said, I think it's very important to avoid the grass being greener scenario, so that you concentrate on the pull as well as the push, and make sure that what you're going to is going to be beneficial for you all round, because, you know, wherever you go, there you are. And so I think it's really important for most of us, obviously leaving a job or leaving a career is a big deal, and it's not something that we take lightly. So I would say that making sure that what you move on to is something that is going to suit you. But I'm going to qualify that slightly as well, seeing as we're talking specifically today about women. And it's certainly true, I think, that women are less likely to take the plunge and to hold themselves out as being able to do something that's not quite the same as what they're doing at the moment. That's something that I think statistically men do a lot more still. And so sometimes it is just worth saying, convincing yourself that actually, yes, you can do something that's a bit different from what you're doing at the moment. And you are more adaptable than maybe you think you are. And that opens up, I think, a lot of possibilities, if that's what suits you. But of course, if that isn't what suits you, then I mean, I know plenty of people who have done very well and been very happy staying within narrower parameters than that. So I suppose the point really is that if you think you might be able to do it and you think you might quite like it, then go for it and do it. And the final point that I wanted to make really is about thinking carefully before you jump. One of my personal trainers in the past said this to me, and he was of course referring to physical exertion, but I think it is just as applicable. It's stuck in my mind for years, and I think it's just as applicable to the professional scenario, which is don't quit, rest. Because I think we all know that quite a lot of the time when you're exhausted, whether that's simply through work or whether that's through caring responsibilities, through children, through just life, that everything seems a lot worse and everything seems a lot more serious, and it's difficult to put it in perspective. Whereas if you can take even a day out, just sort of walk away, rest, then things are a lot easier, I think, to consider and to put in perspective. So that's another little mantra that I thought I'd share if people weren't aware of it, because I found it very helpful over the years.
Thanks, Sarah. That's really helpful and useful stuff. So yeah, as I said earlier, we've got lots of questions. So we've got a question from Lauren, who is new to a law firm and has just started at her first ever firm. She's asked, what is something that the panel thinks that they did right when they were first starting out in their career? And is there anything that they regret? So Fran, perhaps can we start with you, and then maybe we can move around to the other panelists?
Yeah, sure. I suppose for me, the thing that I think made me good at what I did was I listened to everything and everyone, took everything in and on board. It's really easy to have like a preconceived idea when you ask a question of what you think is the right answer that somebody's going to tell you. So you don't listen to the answer. You just like ask the question for the sake of asking the question. And the one thing that I really did was, and some of it, obviously, you have to filter out the answers and understand which you want to actually really take on board and move forward with. But being inquisitive and asking all the questions possible and listening. Listening is such an underrated skill for everything. People don't listen enough to anything. So actually having the ability to listen to answers and to listen and take everything on board, I think, was something that in my first part of my career, I did more than anybody else. Listen to everything I possibly could. Any coach, any mentor, anybody that said, Fran, have you thought about trying it like this? Have you thought about doing that? I've got this idea about this. I always listened to what everybody, all the information that was coming in at me. So I had a full around the picture and I could then process it myself to achieve along the way.
Thanks, Ryan. I think we could all learn from that and be better listeners. That would be definitely help. Emma?
So I think probably the best thing I did was say yes to something was there was an opportunity that meant actually it wasn't a strict legal opportunity. So when I was training, it allowed me to go off and get broader experience, but it meant that I had a longer training period. But it also gave me that breadth and oversight of tech, really. And as someone who wanted to specialise in that area from the get-go, I was really grateful for doing that, even though it wasn't very popular because it meant that people would have to spend longer as a trainee. So that was definitely the thing that I was really pleased I accepted.
Thanks. And Sue?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a bit similar to Fran. Is that I think what really helped me was just enthusiasm and curiosity. And that's what I would say to anyone starting out in their career, whatever career it is, because you're not expected to be an expert. I think sometimes you feel, oh, you know, now I'm a qualified lawyer, everyone expects me to, you know, and yeah, we expect you to do a good job, but you're still starting out. So it's enthusiasm and commitment and curiosity, which I think helps you do a better job, but also makes it just much more fun because you really get stuck in and you put your, you know, all your effort in. I think that would be the key thing I would say.
Great. So we've covered kind of the start of the career and what you do differently. We also had another question that overlaps with this, kind of asking about tips for kind of as you progress. So as you're looking to make that next step in your career, kind of how do you know what step you should take and where can you go to find the right guidance for that? So this overlaps with mentoring, which we covered with Caroline, and also Sarah, kind of your career path. So I'm not sure if Sarah or Caroline, if you want to jump in.
I mean, I guess it's being brave. So things always crop up in life and you never know what opportunity is going to present itself. So it's having the curiosity within yourself and not being frightened of taking a leap and saying, do you know what, if this isn't working for me, I want to do something differently, then grasping it. And I know one of the other questions was around when we started out in our career, was there anything that we regretted? One of the things that I always look back on was I had an opportunity that I was faced with and I didn't take it. And I always look at it and I think, if only, what would have happened had I gone for that? And it was combining tech, which I'm passionate about, but also motorsport, which I'm equally passionate about. And it was a job working as an in-house lawyer for a Formula One team. And I guess I suffered from imposter syndrome at that point. And I didn't think, do you know what, I could do that, because they wanted somebody with a few more PQE than me. And I should have just gone for it. I should have put myself out there and at least tried. So I look back on that and think I wish I'd done it. So to me, it's about, you know, being brave, giving it a go, and just doing your best. And then thinking that, you know, everything happens for a reason. You end up where you are, make the best of it. And if you don't like it, then I think it's important to look at other things.
Yeah, and can I, Katie, just jump in for a minute there? I completely agree with that. And I also think whilst it's really important to listen to the right people, as everybody said, really, I think there's something else to it, which is that if you have an instinct and you know in your heart of heart that what you want to do is right for you, it's also important not to listen to too many people who might be trying to talk you out of that. So connecting it with the question about early on in their career, in our career, I left a very well-paid job at one point to go and retrain. And it was just something that I really felt that I wanted to do, but everyone at the time, apart from my mum, thought I was crazy, and everybody was saying to me, are you sure you want to do this? Look at what you're giving up. And I just was keeping my eyes on the prize of a few years down the line, doing a job that I knew would be more fulfilling than the current one. And it was, yeah, it was difficult at the time, but looking back on it, that was transformative and is one of the reasons that I'm now doing a job that I really love. So I think if you do have an instinct, that you should also listen to that as well as external influences.
Great, thanks Sarah. And I think one theme that I think people listening will have been getting from this whole thing is we've been getting lots of great advice, which is obviously wonderful. But we have a really good question in the Q&A, which is, the person said, I feel like people always mention the good advice they've been given, but can you remember any bad advice that you were given that you've learned from? Maybe Fran, do you want to start with that one? And then if anyone else has a burning desire to answer it as well, we don't need to name and shame, just, you know.
Any bad advice? There's probably been a lot along the years. Fran, like, you should do this. And yeah, well, one, blooming egg, this is quite a funny one. So I was sponsored by a company that do health products, so food and stuff, and somebody thought it'd be a good idea to dress me up as a mermaid and sit me on a starting block, which literally I should never have taken that advice. Like, it's just like, can you imagine it? It's just horrendous, isn't it? And somebody advised Fran, yeah, this would be great for your profile, go dress up as a mermaid and sit on a starting block. Not only that, the starting block wasn't even attached to the pool, so I ended up falling in this mermaid costume that I couldn't move in, and the starting block's falling on top of me. I come out of it injured. So there's, I suppose, a bit of a lighter one to that.
I love that. That's brilliant. I want to see photos now.
No, it's awful.
I have to say, one of the worst bits of advice I got, and I hope very much that women don't get this advice now, because it's a quite gendered advice, I think, is I remember being quite junior and someone saying, Sue, you need to work on your gravitas. And I was like, what does that even mean? And the conclusion was it meant you need to stop being so friendly and bubbly, and then you need to be more serious, because lawyers are serious. And the men who were giving me this advice were kind of older, suited, kind of more serious folks. And I tried, to be honest, to follow this advice, given that you're meant to listen to advice from older mentor people. But I mean, I wasn't really able to follow it because it wasn't authentic to me. So, you know, there's a time and the place to be friendly, but actually in the jobs we do, having good client relationship skills are really important. So I think that's one thing. If anyone says to you, if someone gives you advice that they probably wouldn't give to a man, I would just, you know, take it with a pinch of salt, because it takes all sorts.
There wasn't very many male mermaids, that was for sure.
I mean, Fran, didn't you also get advice to swim like a man?
Yeah, that's another classic. Oh, thinking it's a compliment to tell me that I swim, like, my strokes are very manly, can swim like a man. I was like, no, I swim like me. I don't need to swim like anybody but me. Why would I think that that's a compliment? Compliment would be, Fran, your technique's incredible. Not, you swim like a man. It was just like, sometimes you just got to roll your eyes at those kind of things, haven't you? But yeah, there's still that in sport. There's still very much, like, there's only, I think, one female coach on the whole of British swimming's team. The whole board's male. It's still a very male-dominated environment. But which is quite interesting, because with my sport, there's not many men in the world that could probably swim as fast as me. So you kind of get a lot of respect for what you do as a female sportswomen. Sometimes go, well, I could do that. Like, I can run as fast as them. I can play football better than them. But actually with what I do, not a lot of men can actually swim a length of the pool as fast as me. So I was quite fortunate from the outside world that I've never really had that much of a gender discrimination, apart from being told I swim like a man, which just infuriated me, because actually the men are useless and the females have far better techniques anyway. Maybe cut that bit out. I might be in trouble for that one.
I think maybe the key takeaway there is, you know, to do you, yeah, and definitely, to believe that what you're doing is just fine, and you don't need to compare yourself to other people regardless of their gender. That's great. We've got 4 minutes. So I think we do have one more question we might have time for from Alicia. So how important do you find setting boundaries in your daily job and routine? I'm not sure if anyone in the panel wants to jump in.
It's just very hard, I think, is all I'd say. I think people talk about work-life balance, and I've always said I don't think there is balance. I think it kind of tips at different times. And as long as overall you're happy and content, it's fine. But there are going to be weeks where you're working all hours, and there's going to be other weeks where you're spending time with your family. So that's what I think. I think you should try and set boundaries, but in the jobs that we do, it's not always possible to have a complete balance, but you want to have good well-being. So you need to be conscious of it, but I think not to get too hung up on when it's not always completely balanced, because that's probably never going to be that achievable.
I think it's probably easier depending on where you are in but both how much of a team you have around you, and that you actually all pull, if you're all pulling in the same direction as a team, then you can have, people can cover for one another. I agree absolutely with Sue that it's really hard to set boundaries. I wish I'd have set a few more actually around some of the, you know, the hard rules of things that I wouldn't miss and things that I wouldn't do on reflection, but it's really easy for me to say that with hindsight. And I think actually what I've taken is that I should never ask members of my team to do something similar.
Yeah, that's a really nice note. Sorry, Sarah.
I think particularly with the last 18 months, and there's been a lot more working from home, I think really simple things that have helped me, as like the others, I have struggled with it. Obvious things like physical boundaries. So I now keep all my work and my working devices in one room. And except if I, other than when I absolutely have to, I don't move them from that room, so that when I'm not physically in this room at home, I'm with the children, or, you know, I'm doing different things. So it sounds quite simple, but it's actually worked really well for me, is when I shut the door on this room, even if it's just for half an hour, 45 minutes, I'm thinking about something else, and I can't see my laptop, and I can't see the papers that need looking at. And that's really, really helpful, I think.
That's great, Sarah. Thanks. And I think that's probably a really good note to finish on. So I suppose all that's left really is to say thank you to Fran for her wonderful speech. Really enjoyed it. And to all our great panelists, to our attendees for their great questions as well. And I think we've covered a lot of really great topics. So big goal setting and motivation, how to overcome imposter syndrome and the benefits of that. So thank you all for joining us today. And I hope you've enjoyed it as much as Katie and I have enjoyed speaking to everyone today. Thanks.
Thanks,
everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.